I would like to thank the Texas Heart Institute and the School of Perfusionists for this kind invitation. It's really my great honor to be here today for this 2020 Perfusion Conference. And why this year is very important is because we honor Terry Crane. Terry worked nonstop with Dr. Denton Cooley for the School of Perfusionists, and he made a great contribution over the last 40 years. This is my disclosures. Before we proceed, I would like also to thank Scott Weldon for providing these beautiful illustrations that you are going to see over the next few slides. And also I would like to thank the entire team of perfusionists, anesthesiologists, as well as the operating room nurses. In addition, I would really like to thank my partner, teacher, and mentor, Dr. Coselli, with whom I'm working clinically for the last 12 years. So the talk is related to thoracic aortic aneurysm repair, a step-by-step approach. And we're going to divide this talk into two parts. The first part, we're going to talk for the proximal ascending repair and arch repair. And the second part, we'll talk for the thoracoabdominal aortic repair. So the proximal aorta can come in different configurations, as we'll see. The aneurysm can be only confined into the aortic root or can be in the mid-descending aorta with the aortic root being normal, or can involve the aortic root as well as the ascending aorta, or can be a mega aorta, meaning the ascending aorta is dilated, the arch is dilated, as well as the entire thoracoabdominal aorta is dilated. These are the different surgical strategies that we have in our armamentarium when we deal with diseases affecting the ascending aorta, and the aortic arch. This is the classic, what we call Marfanoid route, where the ascending aorta is normal, and the root is the one that is dilated. And in this case, the ascending aorta does not need to be replaced, but we replace or repair the aortic root. This is another case where hypothermic circulatory arrest is not required, but we replace or we repair the aortic root and we replace the ascending aorta. In this case, a cross clamp can be placed in the ascending aorta and we carry on with the repair. As we see here, the way that we go on cardiopulmonary bypass is the classic way by cannulating the ascending aorta. Then we give cardioplegia and we put a cross clamp. The way that the cardioplegia, it is actually our strategy to give antegrade, a retrograde cardioplegia. Antegrade cardioplegia is being given direct into the aortic root if there's no aortic insufficiency. In case that there is aortic insufficiency, then we open the aorta and we give direct into the ostea of the coronary arteries. And then, of course, we give an alternate we give cardioplegia alternate, retrograde, and antegrade. After the cross clamp is placed, the ascending aorta is open, and then we replace it with a Dacron graft. We proceed with the distal anastomosis first, and then we proceed with the proximal repair. The proximal repair can involve aortic valve replacement, aortic root repair, or aortic root replacement, depending on the pathology. In case like this one, where the ascending aorta as well as the proximal arch is involved, then we have to institute a period of circulatory arrest because cross clamp cannot be placed in this particular situation. So the way that we proceed is, first of all, we have to establish an arterial inflow for cardiopulmonary bypass. The way that we establish the arterial inflow is via the axillary cannulation or an omnet cannulation with an 8 or a 10 millimeter graft. Is our strategy to always use an 8 or a 10 millimeter graft, even though across the country, there are aortic centers that they actually cannulate direct the axillary artery or the anomnet artery. So after we establish the arterial inflow, the patient goes on cardiopulmonary bypass. And this is just to mention an algorithm that was published in the Journal of Thoracic and Cardiovascular Surgery 2 years ago, where is an algorithm how we decide to proceed with the axillary cannulation versus the anomnet cannulation. In case of redo sternotomy, when the cardiac structures are very close into the chest wall, then axillary cannulation is our preferred strategy. In case it is a primary repair, then we proceed in the elective cases, usually the anomnet artery cannulation, unless the head vessels are very dilated, where axillary cannulation is our the choice that we use. So in case that I saw before, where the ascending aorta needs to be replaced as well as the aortic arch, we'll start with anomnet or axillary cannulation. Our mean temperature, we cool down to 24 degrees. We use what we call moderate hypothermia. According to the consensus of experts, moderate hypothermia is defined between 20 degrees Celsius to 28 degrees Celsius. And is our preference to cool down to approximately 23 to 25 degrees Celsius as a mean temperature. Then, when the target temperature is approached, then we decrease the flows down to 10 to 15 ml per kilo per minute. And the snare is down, as you see on the picture, over the anomnet artery. And we start what we call the antegrade cerebral perfusion via the right common carotid artery. At that point also, we monitor the NEARs. Then the aorta is open and we proceed by placing the second cannula via the left common carotid artery. The flows, as we said, they are 10 to 15 ml per kilo per minute. The cannula that we place into the left common carotid artery is connected via a Y connector. As we see, the one Y is connected into the anomnet or the axillary artery, and the other Y is via the cannula that is going into the left common carotid artery. The cannula of choices that we like to use is a 9 French Prui, but lately, over the last year, we have switched to the a cardioplegia cannula that is a little larger diameter, so the resistance is a little less when the flow goes to the left common carotid artery. And this is another representation where you can very well see the Y connector with the blood going through the right common carotid artery and then via the other cannula into the left common carotid artery. So after the antegrade cerebral perfusion is initiated, then we proceed with the distal repair. The repair close into the by replacing the proximal aortic arch. After the replacement is completed, then the snare, we take the snare off and we start going slowly to full flow. At that point, when we go to full flow, a cross clamp is placed into the distal, into the dacron graft, and we start rewarming. In case that the pathology is more extensive, then we need to proceed with the total arch replacement. In these cases, the total arch can be done either as an island reimplantation or as a double Y graft. when we do it as an island reimplantation, then while we do the anastomosis, the distal anastomosis, as well as the island, when we're cooled down to 23 or 24 degrees Celsius, and then after the anastomosis is complete, we proceed like the previous repair, where a cross clamp is placed into the dacron graft, and then we proceed with the rest of the proximal repair that can be repair of the aortic valve or replacement, or just a graft into the proximal aorta. In case that the total arch needs to be replaced by using a trifurcated or bifurcated graft, then the sequence can be a little different, because after we place the patient on cardiopulmonary bypass, the anastomosis of the subclavian and the carotid can be performed while we're cooling down. And then when we reach the target temperature, 23 or 24 degrees Celsius, then we proceed with the circulatory arrest with antegrade cerebral perfusion. The distal anastomosis, as we see here, is performed. And after the distal anastomosis is performed, we go back to full flow, a cross clamp is placed, and slowly we start rewarming. At that point, we have already a cannula that is connected into the side branch, as we see in the image, and the rest of the body is perfused at that point. So let's switch gears now into the thoracoabdominal aortic aneurysm repair, the step-by-step approach. Of course, as we mentioned before, the pathology is the one that really determines the approach. And these are the different classifications as are classified by Dr. Crawford. We have the extent one aneurysm that is extended from the subclavian down to the level of the visceral vessels. The extent two from the subclavian artery all the way down to the bifurcation. The extent three, mid-descending thoracic aorta down to the bifurcation. And then the extent four, aneurysm that is extended from the around the visceral vessels to the down to the bifurcation. And of course, the repairs are followed. We have extent one repair from the subclavian artery below the level of the renals, the extent two replacement from the subclavian artery that we place all the way down to the bifurcation, the extent three replacement by where we replace the mid-descending aorta down to the bifurcation, and then the extent four aneurysm replacement where the repair involves the visceral vessels down to the aortic bifurcation. A lot of times we use the term elephant trunk repair. This is when we have already replaced the proximal aorta, and at that point we come back a few months later and we replace the thoracoabdominal aorta by connecting the prior graft that we have from proximal repair into the new graft which is used for the second stage repair. In case that the pathology help us is not very extensive, then the endovascular techniques can really help us. And the second stage can be done with endovascular arrhythmia repair. Let's go through the steps of the thoracoabdominal repair. First of all, the reason why we treat the thoracoabdominal aneurysm is to prevent death secondary to rupture. So the patient is placed with the right side down, left side up. We like to use the thoracoabdominal incision via the sixth intercostal arrhythmia space. And the patient is placed on left heart bypass. The way that we place the patient on left heart bypass is that we use as an inflow the left inferior pulmonary vein, and then as an outflow, as we'll see on the image, the descending thoracic aorta. After the patient is placed on left heart bypass, then a cross clamp is placed distal to the left subclavian artery, or sometimes the cross clamp is placed between the left common carotid and the left subclavian artery. Then the aorta is opened and we proceed with the proximal anastomosis. This proximal anastomosis is performed with the left heart bypass on. Then, after the completion of the proximal anastomosis, the left heart bypass is off and the rest of the aorta is open. And we perfuse, we identify the visceral vessels. Depending on the situation, sometimes we do perfuse the visceral vessels. As we see on this image, we use the blood of the pump to perfuse the SMA artery as well as the celiac artery. And then we have the circuit, the cold crystalloid or custodial circuit, where we give the cold into a cold solution into the left renal and the right renal artery. So we continue with our repair by proceeding with the intercostal left midi patch. And then we see here in this image where we have the two catheters into the superior mesenteric artery and the celiac artery, as well as the cold solution into the left renal and the right renal artery. After the completion of the intercostal patch, in case that we have to proceed, like in this image, with what we call the tetrafurcated graft, where all the visceral vessels are separated anastomosed to each artery, the second, next step is to proceed with the distal anastomosis. In this case, as we said, the left heart bypass is off. We just give visceral perfusion. We use the blood of the pump to perfuse the SMA as well as the celiac artery. And we use the cold renal solution to give cold renal into the right and the left renal artery during the distal anastomosis. When the distal anastomosis is completed, then the next step, we concentrate into the visceral vessels. At that point, the sequence, we start with the right renal artery. We continue the perfusion into the SMA and the celiac artery, and we continue the cold renal perfusion into the left renal artery. Then the next artery that we re-implant is the SMA, and we continue with the celiac artery. At that point, the patient continues to get renal perfusion via the left renal artery. And the last vessel that we anastomose is the left renal artery. And then the repair is completed. As we see here, the repair can be actually performed by two ways, or by using a tetrafurcated graft, as we just depicted, or by just using the island technique, where all the visceral vessels are re-implanted at once. When we use the patch anastomosis, then the sequence can be a little different, because the patch anastomosis is completed after we do the intercostal patch, and the distal anastomosis is actually at the end. I would like really to thank you for this great invitation. It's a great privilege to be here today, and it's my pleasure throughout the years to work with all of you. Thank you, and I hope to see you soon.